Okay, the next item of business, a debate on motion 11652 in the name of Neil Gray on application of the Strikes Minimum Service Levels Act 2023 in Scotland. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and I call on Neil Gray to speak to and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary, around 12 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion in my name and that of my colleagues. I move the motion in my name and that of my colleagues. Today, I seek Parliament's support for the Scottish Government's continued opposition to the Strikes Minimum Level Services Act and any associated secondary legislation. These are challenging times. In the aftermath of Brexit, COVID-19, the war in Ukraine and the cost crisis, topped off by Liz Truss and Kwasi Kwarteng's mini-budget last year. So we now confront some of the most formidable economic conditions in living memory. These times call for us to share our vision of how we face these challenges head on, while providing clarity on how we will seek to build a better future. This government's vision is for an economy that is fair, is green, and is growing. A country that provides a promising future for every worker, their families, and communities, supported by a robust labour market. The Scottish Parliament is limited in what it can do, but we will continue to do all we can to resist this Act. Today's debate is a testament to that, where we hope to secure Parliament's support for our position. Trade unions stand as a cornerstone of Scottish democracy, playing a pivotal role in realising our fair work ambitions as we successfully transition to net zero. These ambitions in turn form the bedrock of a wellbeing economy, providing workers with better job quality, pay, economic security and work-life balance, and employers and an available workforce with the right skills aligned to the needs of businesses and our economy. The STUC represents around 540,000 trade unionists and members of 39 affiliated trade unions and 20 trade union councils. It can speak for the interests of female workers, black workers, young workers, and those who suffer discrimination, not just in the workplace, but also as part of civil society. To genuinely foster an inclusive society with well-being at its heart, a strong economy, a goal I believe most members of this chamber share, these voices are invaluable in development of economic and social policies. Only recently, the First Minister and I held a biannual meeting with the STUC and their affiliates where the issue of minimum service levels was raised. Alongside the First Minister, I made a commitment to do everything in our power to resist the implementation of the Strikes Act. Back in 2016, by all means.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving it. He's quite right. At the heart of this is the role of the trade unions in representing workers. But actually, is there not much more a fundamental principle, that of the relationship between worker and their work and their right to withdraw their labour when all they have to exchange is their labour itself?
Yes. Cabinet Secretary.
Absolutely. I wholeheartedly agree. And I think that's a principle Daniel Johnson and I share, which is why I hope we can secure Labour support for the motion that we have before us this evening. Back in 2016, we saw the introduction of the Trade Union Act, a direct threat to workers' rights. Not content with the most anti-trade union laws in Western Europe, the UK Government's way of managing the recent spate of industrial disputes was to further that with the conduct of Employment Agencies and Employment Businesses Amendment Regulations 2022. And while the High Court has quashed this legislation permitting the use of agency workers to replace those taking part in strike action, the UK Government are consulting on this matter again, relentless in their efforts to curb or mitigate strike action. And while this goes on in the background, we're now faced with the implementation of the Strikes Act and the associated secondary legislation, which encroaches on devolved services. It is not just that it is unnecessary, unwanted and ineffective, but it seeks to undermine legitimate trade union activity and does not respect the Scottish Government's fair work principles. Governments should be working with the public sector and trade unions to reach fair and reasonable settlements, respecting the legitimate interests of workers, not seeking to curb their right to strike. And despite this Act, and while employment law remains reserved to the UK Parliament, we will continue to use the levers at our disposal to promote fairer work practices across the labour market in Scotland. Fair work is a model for innovation and success, with many employers in Scotland working alongside trade unions to implement fair work practices. Fair work supports stronger productivity, economic growth and greater well-being. Earlier this week, I met with trade unions to discuss fair work and hear the views on how we're progressing in delivering our shared ambitions. For alongside supporting employers, Our Fair Work Action Plan includes actions to support trade unions. We want to build an economy where our businesses, industries and trade unions thrive, and where economic success works for all. There is clear evidence that unionised workplaces have more engaged staff, have higher staff level of training, and a progressive approach to staff wellbeing. We are committed to supporting strong trade unions in Scotland for the benefit of all workers and our economy. This is in contrast to recent Westminster Government labour market policies, which are moving in the opposite direction. Inadequate enforcement of minimum employment standards, including the national minimum wage, the introduction of the Trade Union Act 2016 and now the Strikes Act 2023. I and my ministerial colleagues have written on several occasions to UK ministers expressing our fervent opposition to the introduction of minimum service levels, as well as concerns around the associated codes of practice. Most recently, on the 4th of December, my colleague Fiona Hislop wrote to the Minister of State at the Department for Transport, and this was in relation to the publication of the UK Government's consultation response in the laying of the minimum service levels on Passenger Railway Services Regulations 2023. Despite Mrs Hislop's letter clearly articulating our position, the regulations have now been approved and are now in effect. Nevertheless, we have consistently maintained our position that we should collaborate with transport operators and trade unions to achieve fair and reasonable settlements, while respecting the legitimate interests of workers and transport organisations. Unlike the approach of the UK Government, which since 2019 has not had, we have not had a single day without either a strike or on their railways or mandates for strikes outstanding for them. The UK Government's introduction of the Strikes Act not only ignores the devolution settlement, but fails to recognise the authority of the Scottish Government in devolved areas. By reserving the sole authority to ministers to set the minimum service levels, they can be set at such a high level that any strike will be rendered largely ineffectual, a point I'm sure Daniel Johnson was referring to in his intervention. Moreover, UK Government have established minimum service levels for passenger services in which Scotland cover rail, Edinburgh Trams and Glasgow Subway. Fortunately, the minimum service level set for ambulance services have been limited to England. However, further regulations will be forthcoming as UK Government plan to extend minimum service levels to other sectors. In November, the UK Government's Department for Education launched a consultation on minimum service levels for education services in Great Britain, including schools, colleges and universities. The Scottish Government does not intend on providing a formal response to this consultation, nor will it assist with the development of any regulations that may arise from this consultation, because in doing so, it would only seek to serve the harmful objectives of the Strikes Act. And let me be clear, however, that Scottish ministers have no intention of asking any employers within its influence to issue work notices. Instead, we will continue to encourage employers and trade unions within the Scottish education sectors to work together constructively to seek resolutions to industrial disputes. The UK Government's introduction of this wholly unwelcome act is unnecessarily inflammatory and will therefore act against the interests of the public. But we are not alone in opposing this legislation. As it progressed through the UK Parliament, the Welsh Government was utterly opposed. They called it a bill that represents a nakedly political and opportunist attack on the rights and dignity of public service workers, and upon royal assent reiterated their opposition and continued fundamental concerns about the impact of the Act on devolved public service delivery in Wales. The Trade Union Congress has reported the UK Government to the International Labour Organization over the Act, and its Congress recently backed a motion calling for the devolution of employment law to Scotland, a view, as confirmed by Anna Sauer early in November, shared by Scottish Labour. Whilst UK Labour have stated that they would repeal the Strikes Act should they be successful at the next UK general election, which is welcome news. They don't share Scottish Labour's view that employment powers should be devolved to the Scottish Parliament, which is in stark contrast to our position, which is clear. Securing the full range of powers in relation to employment will empower the Scottish Parliament to fully implement policies that will best meet Scotland's distinct needs and help to shift the curve on poverty and deliver our shared ambition for a fairer, greener and more prosperous Scotland. The Scottish Government is committed to realising our vision for Scotland to be a leading Fair Work nation by 2025. Fair Work is the catalyst for success, wellbeing and prosperity for individuals, businesses, organisations and society as a whole. in a marked divergence to Westminster's labour market policies. And we're not alone in thinking this. In the words of Labour's Baroness Brian of Partick, in reference to the passage of the Anti-Strikes Act through the Lords, she said, "Scottish and Welsh fair work arrangements do not prevent industrial disputes, but do allow constructive dialogue between government, employers and trade unions, so that when disputes occur, there is greater goodwill to resolve them." She also stated that the bill presented a strong case for devolving employment law to Holyrood and that the Sewell Convention has been abused repeatedly, rendering it no longer meaningful. And this is exactly the point: a further encroachment on the devolved settlement and an undermining, an unnecessary undermining of trade union relations, which actually force further industrial disputes elsewhere. The UK is now becoming a global outlier, according to the International Trade Union Confederation. Having fallen from a rating of 3, where the ITUC considers there are regular violations of workers' rights, to 4, where the Confederation says there are systematic violations. Our request of Parliament today is to recognise and endorse our distinct approach to industrial relations and trade union, which is, unlike in that of the UK, one which is based on partnership working. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I can advise the Chamber there's a bit of time in hand for this debate this afternoon. I now call on Murdo Fraser to speak to and move Amendment 11652.1. Mr Fraser, around 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start with two expressions of regret in relation to this afternoon's debate? First, I am very sorry I'm not able to be in the Chamber in person this afternoon due to an injury. And secondly, whilst I'm very happy to engage in this debate on the Strikes Minimum Service Levels Act 2023, I really do regret that the Scottish Government are devoting the afternoon at this point to discussing what is essentially a matter of reserved legislation. There are a whole range of issues affecting the Scottish economy which fall under the remit of the Cabinet Secretary, which we could be discussing today. We could be looking at Scotland's economic performance. We could be looking at the challenges in sectors such as hospitality right at the moment and their demands that the 75% rate relief issued by the Chancellor to retail, hospitality and leisure businesses in England and Wales be passed on to businesses in Scotland in the coming year, as indeed, of course, it wasn't done in the present year. We could be looking at what the Scottish Government are going to be doing in their budget on Tuesday to support economic growth and those sectors of the economy that are currently struggling. And in that respect, I was very interested to read in the newspapers that the Cabinet Secretary is fighting a battle within the Cabinet to oppose additional tax rises, which would widen the income tax differential between Scotland and the rest of the UK still further. I would certainly wish him well in his endeavours in that respect, although if the latest reports are to be believed, it looks like he has lost that battle already in humiliating fashion. And if that is true, and we'll find that out on Tuesday, it will be deeply damaging to the economy and our prospects for growth, with a message that would send out about how unattractive Scotland is as a place for those looking to set up and grow businesses. That is not just my view, but it's one universally held across business representative organisations in Scotland. But regrettably, instead of those matters being the focus of the Scottish Government's debate this afternoon, we have yet another set of grievances with the UK Government, this time in relation to this legislation on minimum service levels, which came into law on the 20th of July this year. And I have to start taking issue with the statement in the motion from the Cabinet Secretary claiming that this legislation encroaches on the devolved responsibilities of the Scottish Parliament. Now, what this legislation actually does impact upon are reserved areas insofar as they apply to Scotland. So matters such as border security. Yes, if the Minister wants to intervene, I'll give way.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, I wish Murdo Fraser well. Having seen him the morning that he injured himself, I could understand why he'd be subject to be housebound. And I wish him well for a recovery from what appeared to be a very sore injury. Is he not concerned about where I concluded my remarks around the downgrading of the International Trade Union Congress and what they have said around the UK government's position, which is clearly an outlier in terms of workers' rights? And is he not concerned that the cross-border rail, oil is currently being impacted by these regulations, and it gives the right to all Secretaries of State of, in the UK to be able to come forward with secondary legislation that can impact upon devolved competence. Is he not concerned by that?
Murdo Fraser, I can give you the time back.
Thank you. Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his very kind words. Hopefully I will be back in chamber next week. But in relation to this point about impact on devolved matters, I'm afraid he is simply wrong in what he has to say, because the issue of notices is a matter for the employing organisation or body. And so while it's true that matters such as border security, the passport office, nuclear decommissioning, do come under the remit of this legislation, and that would be a matter for UK ministers, which is the case under our current constitutional settlement. When it comes to devolved responsibilities, it's a matter for the Scottish Government to determine whether such notices are issued. It's not a matter for the UK Government to determine that. And if the Cabinet Secretary doesn't understand that, he hasn't read the legislation and he hasn't read the explanatory notes that make that absolutely clear. So what he's trying to do is stir up some grievance in this debate, grievance that is simply groundless and without any substance. Now, let's look at the principles behind the bill. We all accept there is a right. Yes, I'll give way to them.
Cabinet Secretary. In that case, how does he explain the consultation that is currently underway on the education front, which includes schools, colleges and universities, or indeed the wider NHS consultation, which could also have an impact in this matter?
Murdo Fraser.
Well, the Cabinet Secretary surely understands that the issue of notices is a matter for the employer. In this case, the employer would be the local authority or the Scottish Government, depending on which body he's talking about. The UK Government cannot issue these notices to imply in Scotland. That's not what the legislation currently says, and it's just a matter of grievance being stirred up by the Cabinet Secretary. Now, going back to the point I was going to make about where this fits in with wider employment law, I would recognise the ability to strike is an important part of industrial relations in the United Kingdom, rightly protected by law. And it follows from that an element of disruption is inherent in any strike. But that said, the public does expect there to be some level of essential protections put in place, even where strikes are taking place. And what any government has to do is to try to get the appropriate balance. I'm not going to take another intervention at this stage, Mr. Johnson. I've taken two and I need to make some progress. What the government has to do is strike an appropriate balance between the ability to strike and protecting lives and livelihoods. And we do, of course, even before this legislation has been put in place, already have protections, for example, the armed services or for the police, protecting individuals from strikes. But what this legislation does is extend these categories to ensure protection of the public. And there is nothing unusual about this if we look at the wider European context. Most countries in Europe have restrictions on strike action, including the provision of minimum service levels. Now, it's true that the list of professions covered differs from country to country, but I would commend to members the research done by the House of Commons Library that looks country by country at the restrictions that are put into place. Some countries, such as Portugal or Greece, have explicit frameworks set out in statute for sectors where minimum standards must be provided. In other countries, for example, Germany or the Netherlands, there are no explicit statutory minimum service laws, but court rulings have allowed restrictions to be imposed in practice for certain services where the right to strike is balanced against competing public interests. In France, there are elements of both statutory and non-statutory restrictions. It is only in very few European countries that there are no minimum service requirements in law at all. For example, Poland or Austria. But in Poland, there is still an extensive list of professions prohibited from striking altogether. Across Europe, the breadth and extent of minimum service levels varies considerably. Finland and Croatia draw these restrictions narrowly around the protection of lives, public safety, and or property that would otherwise be in danger. Other countries state that the competing requirement is a broader public interest test, which, while they need to provide services essential to the community, which can include healthcare, emergency services, education, transport, energy, and communications. Different European countries take different approaches as to how these laws will work in practice. In Romania and Greece, for example, a flat rate, one-third of regular service, is set across all restricted services. but most countries determine the actual maintenance service levels on a case-by-case basis. So what we're seeing here is this legislation is simply bringing the United Kingdom into line with the norm across most European countries. And given it is the stated intent of the Scottish government to align itself with the rest of the EU, I'm just somewhat surprised they are resisting this legislation, because all it does is brings it into line with the practice in most European countries. But as I've said before, even if the Scottish government does object to this bill, it does not have to implement these minimum service levels. It will be for the Scottish minister to determine, in relation to devolved areas, whether these are brought in. And as we've heard, the Scottish government has no intention of doing so. So what we have here, presiding officer, is the proverbial storm in a teacup. With everyone's view on the need for minimum service levels, whether they are appropriate or not, they will only apply in Scotland if Scottish ministers decide they're going to implement them. So this whole debate is just about posturing and constitutional grievance from the SNP, once again trying to stir up a fight with Westminster when there are far more important things they could be spending their time on. And with that, I'm very pleased to move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr. Fraser, and I too wish you a speedy recovery. I now call on Daniel Johnson to speak to and move Amendment 11652.2, around 6 minutes, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I remind the Chamber of my register of interests and my declarations regarding trade union membership? And can I move the amendment in my name? Indeed, I thought it was somewhat striking in the speech that Murdo Fraser just gave that he fully took a quarter of his speech before he even attempted to defend his own government's policy, that he spent 2 whole minutes essentially seeking to deflect and indeed apologise. Because what I would say is this: what does it say about a party of government that, rather than seeking to use its legislative capacity, seeks to use the time and powers it has available to it, not to look at the situation in the country, look at solutions, looking at how it can seek to serve the people, but uses that time to seek to trap the party of opposition and to attack it? Indeed, I would say, what does it say about the party of opposition? That it has the vision and the willingness to government that the incumbent party seeks to attack it. Because that is what this bit of legislation has been about. And it's somewhat ironic, Murdo Fraser talking about this being a storm in a teacup, because fundamentally what the Conservative Party, just in a moment, Mr. Whittle, has been seeking to is to wind back the clock, invoke memories of Longbridge and industrial dispute. It's yet another chapter in the culture wars, because the Conservatives are a party that are simply out of ideas and, I would wager, are out of time. Mr. Whittle.
Brian Whittle.
Very grateful for Daniel Johnson for giving me. I just wonder if he recognises the fact that both he and I are both in opposition at the moment.
Daniel Johnson.
It'll be interesting to see what 2024 brings. What I would say about this legislation is threefold. First of all, it is wrong in effect, it is wrong in its analysis, and most fundamentally, it is wrong in principle. So much of Murdo Fraser's assertion was that we need this to bring us into line with Europe. He cited the House of Commons Library briefing. But what he admitted was that self-same briefing points out the fact that minimum service levels don't work in the countries where they exist. If you look at countries like Spain, France, that they lose far more days to strike than the United Kingdom does. And minimum service levels have ended up in the courts, gummed up and frankly getting in the way of industrial relations, not resolving them. And indeed, you don't even need to take my word for it. You only have to listen to the government itself. Its own impact assessment stated that minimum service legislation in the transport sector could increase the number of strikes and disruption. Even the architect of the law from Number 10, Andrew Gilligan, said, and I quote, "The plans may promise more industrial action than they may mitigate, and they won't ensure smooth services." Not my words, Andrew Gilligan's. And ultimately, the Transport Secretary stated in December last year that minimum service levels for rail, and again I quote, is not a solution, and that the way to get a better service was to resolve the dispute. Well, amen to that. If only the Conservatives would listen to their own people in the Chamber today. But it is also wrong in analysis, because the contention is that we need this for safety. That is simply nonsense. The 1992 Trade Union Act makes it illegal to strike when that endangers a human life and limb. A Conservative law. You would think that they would know their own legislation. But I think it also makes a fundamental mistake, making an assumption that workers want to strike. They do not, and especially not workers working in healthcare, which is why we saw ambulance workers regularly breaking strikes, breaking picket lines in order to do their duty. People that work in our public services want to serve the public. They want to help people. They want to cure people. That is the analysis. I think that the Conservatives need to understand that the level of strikes that we are seeing is not because people want to strike, it's because of the frustration and despair people feel after 13 years of Conservative government and the sorry state of our public services as a result. But most importantly, they are wrong as a matter of principle. Very briefly, Mr. Kerr.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. The member seems very keen to argue about UK situation and UK legislation, notwithstanding that we're in a devolved parliament, the most powerful in the world. Since he's so keen to argue about UK legislation, can we take it he'll be standing for Westminster next year?
Daniel Johnson.
Edinburgh, South Edinburgh is very well served by Mr. Ian Murray, and I wouldn't want to get in his way as he seeks to fight the next election. But look, let me be clear. This legislation is wrong in principle. The right to strike is fundamental for the reasons I set out in my intervention. Indeed, even the Conservatives used to believe this. The right to strike is set out in the European Convention on Human Rights, a treaty championed by Churchill and up until now championed by the Conservative Party. But it is fundamentally rests on this point that when you are a worker, all you have in a capitalist society is your labour as a means of exchange. If you remove the right to strike, you essentially force people to work. It is a form of indenturement and is to be condemned. And that is why it is a matter of concern for the UN's independent labour organisation and why this legislation is so controversial. But just in closing, I think it should be noted that the Scottish Government does have the power simply to ignore this legislation. It doesn't need to serve those notices. Much of the powers and capacities rest here. And I would just gently say to the government, I'm absolutely clear that this legislation must be condemned, but fair work requires a degree of introspection and self-analysis too. And when the government's own analysis on fair work says that there's much work to be done, I would prefer to see a debate which talked about fair work in the main and how we can take it forward rather than simply attacking others. But let's be clear. Within the first 100 days, we will bring forward the New Deal for workers as a Labour government, and it will strike this legislation down. So if you believe in that, you need to vote for Labour, and frankly, I would seek all members to support our amendment, which would deliver exactly what the government seems to be calling for. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Just a cautionary note about electioneering within the chamber. I think we probably stayed just about the right side of that line, but it's probably worth a reminder. And I call Beatrice Wishart. Beatrice Wishart, around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Liberal Democrats are opposed to the application of the Strikes Minimum Service Levels Act 2023, and my Westminster colleagues made this opposition clear during the bill process in the House of Commons. Indeed, the Liberal Democrats tabled an amendment that, had it passed, would have resulted in the House declining to give the bill a second reading. Our reasons for opposing this legislation are many. It's simply another attempt by the Conservatives to distract from their appalling mismanagement of the economy and from their failure to avert strikes in the first place. This legislation will simply not work. Minimum service levels will not avert ongoing crises in public services or help to solve staff shortages in the NHS. Its scope is far too wide and goes well beyond critical services. Not only will it not work, the UK government's legislation does not contain any detail about what minimum services will be, while it hands extraordinary powers to UK government ministers to change current legislation without adequate Parliament scrutiny. It does nothing to resolve industrial disputes, and instead it will only increase the disruption caused by future industrial action. The best way to avoid disruption during strikes is to prevent them in the first place, which means the government getting round the table with staff and employers to find a solution. As my Westminster colleague, Christine Jardine, MP, said, The cause of strikes is the deterioration in public services that the government have presided over. This Act does not undo that deterioration, and it will not help our public sector. The Act is an attempt to use both workers and the state of public services as a political football to distract from the mismanagement that has led to this point. Current poor levels of service have not arisen through anyone's will to have low services. They are as a result of a lack of resources and investment in public services through which staff have struggled to improve and work through. And, Presiding Officer, I don't need 6 minutes because I'm going to conclude by saying that rather than imposing minimum levels of service in a strike situation to make a political point, the UK Government should be investing in public services to improve levels of services all the time. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Wishart. We now move to the open debate. I call first Claire Hawkey to be followed by Liam Kerr. A generous 6 minutes, Ms Hawkey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my register of interests in that I'm a member of the trade union Unison and I hold a bank nurse contract with Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS. Due to the Westminster cost of living crisis, with many people's wages not keeping pace with increases to their cost of living, coupled with years of Tory austerity, people across the UK have been striking in record numbers. Workers in almost every sector have come together to demand better paying conditions. And just as the right to work is a fundamental human right, exercising the right to strike is a fundamental liberty available to most workers. However, a change in the law by the Westminster Tory government threatens this liberty for some of our most vital public services. The strikes, Minimum Service Levels Act 2023, will, under plans announced so far, impact on workers in rail, ambulance service and border security, stipulating minimum service levels in those sectors. And the UK government has also been consulting on the introduction of regulations on minimum service levels to hospital-based health services in England, Scotland and Wales during strike action. Notwithstanding the impact on workers, the Act ignores the devolution settlement and fails to recognise the authority of the Scottish Government in devolved areas. Presiding Officer, the Strikes Minimum Services Levels Act 2023 is just the latest Tory attack on workers' rights. As I started my working life, I had my first experience of exercising my right to withdraw my labour in 1984, when Thatcher's government removed trade union rights at GCHQ. Union members were told to resign their membership or to be sacked. I was proud then, as I remain now, of the tenacity of the workers involved, their families, and the solidarity of the whole trade union movement. But that was not Thatcher's only foray into reducing the powers of trade unionism in the UK. Our government restricted the right to picket, prevent unions bringing their members out in support of other unions, and introduced ballots for strike action. And then in 2016, the Tory government enacted higher thresholds for success on ballots and extended the notice required for industrial action. And now we face yet another crackdown on workers' protections through the minimum services levels legislation. Rightly, the Scottish Government will do everything it can to oppose this appalling piece of anti-worker and anti-trade union legislation, which will undermine, not enhance, industrial relations. Instead of demonising workers and continually limiting their ability to take industrial action, what the UK Government should be doing is giving those in the public sector fair wage rises and proper terms and conditions, whilst providing additional funding across the devolved nations to support fair pay awards. Presiding Officer, Labour, as we've heard it again today, have said that they'll repeal this legislation in the first 100 days of government, which of course I would welcome. However, Sir Keir Starmer has U-turned on previously announced policies almost every other week, so forgive me for not trusting what Labour say. As they continue to move to the right to appeal to Tory voters, who knows what other progressive proposals will end up on the Labour scrap heap. And Labour don't have the best record in this regard either, and I'll take your intervention in just one moment, Mr Mara. Other than overturning the trade union activity within GCHQ, which I mentioned earlier, most restrictions on union activity imposed by successive Tory governments has been kept by Labour governments. And I'll give way to Mr Mara.
Michael Mara.
Thank the member for giving way. If she supports the New Deal for Workers' People as backed by the SDUC and the TUC, will she be voting for it in the Labour amendment today?
Claire Hawkey.
We've been accused of grievance politics. by the Labour Party, by the Tory Party. I'm aggrieved. I'm aggrieved. I don't trust what I hear from the Labour Party. I don't trust you to enact what you say that you're going to do. There have been so many flip-flops by your party leader down in Westminster that I will be supporting what this Scottish Government does and not what the Labour Party proposes. And the party, the Labour Party has hardly got a record to be trumpeted by their members in this Scottish Parliament. In any event, the Tories could simply reenact the legislation the next time they get into government. With Labour refusing to back calls from the Scottish Government and the STUC to devolve employment law, it's clear that they would rather leave Scotland at the mercy of Tory attacks on workers' rights than giving our National Parliament such powers. The only way for Scotland to get rid of Tory governments that we don't vote for good, and by extension, anti-worker and anti-trade union policies, is for Scotland to become an independent country and have control of her own laws. Presiding Officer, the trade union movement has a proud history of protecting workers' rights that was born of a desire to combat exploitation and ensure a fair day's pay for a fair day's work. Trade unions have been at the heart of social and economic change. I've been a proud trade union member all my working life, and prior to being elected as an MSP, I was a divisional convener for Unison for many years, and I've represented NHS staff on numerous issues, from grievances, bullying and harassment claims to appeals against dismissal. As the only nation in the UK to have averted NHS strikes, Scotland has shown that a better, more constructive way is possible, and that's not an accident. It's testament to the fact that this SNP government has worked constructively to produce acceptable offers befitting of the vital workforce and work that our NHS staff do, whilst the Tories have done nothing but level outrageous attacks on our NHS staff and unions. On the minimum service levels legislation, the Royal College of Nursing have said, this provocative move makes future strike action by nurses more likely, not less likely. Ros Foyer, the General Secretary of the STUC, said, there's a real slap in the face for workers who were on the front line during the pandemic and who put themselves and their families at risk to give us key essential public services. These workers are now being told that they may be sacked for taking lawful industrial action. And the chair of the BMA Council said, even before the recent strikes bill, the UK has some of the tightest restrictions on trade union activity in Europe. And now with threats that could see individuals sacked if they do not comply with these new laws, it feels like another kick in the teeth for our profession. These damning statements have been ignored by Westminster, and I echo and support those words. And in closing, Deputy Presiding Officer, Scottish workers deserve to see the back of Westminster's anti-workers agenda once and for all. We in the SNP are clear that a progressive approach to industrial relations built on greater, not fewer, protections for workers is at the heart of a fairer society.
Thank you. And I call Liam Kerr to be followed by Bill Kidd, around 6 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was a little surprised to see that we'd be debating UK legislation proposed, amended, passed by the UK Parliament in this chamber today. I guess it just seemed odd that rather than debate the shocking PISA figures that came out last week showing the decline of education after 16 years of SNP government, something that they left to the Scottish Conservatives to do in our business, or perhaps the housing crisis in Scotland that's arisen due to SNP failures, something they left Labour to bring forward in their business a few weeks ago. It would be UK legislation, the provisions of which are reserved and which almost entirely apply outside Scotland, save in relation to border security, network rail and nuclear decommissioning. That was what the SNP government decided to debate. However, to ensure I was fully familiar with what had happened in the UK Parliament, I got my hands on various documents, including the Act, and I notice that it amends the 1992 Act in such a way as to recognise that the ability to strike is a vital part of industrial relations in the UK, rightly protected by law, whilst seeking to maintain a balance with protecting the safety of the public and maintaining essential services.
Mr. Murray-Todd.
Just in order to bust this myth about this legislation being entirely reserved, the transport minimum service level applies to Network Rail, all train operators, Edinburgh Trams, Glasgow subway. There are no live disputes at the moment, but Network Rail's current pay deal expires at the end of 2023. Caledonian Sleeper pay deal expires on 31st March. There is no way that the opposition can argue that this legislation does not and will not impact on Scotland.
Absolutely. Liam Kerr, give you the time back.
The opposition is actually suggesting that this is the fundamental question. Why are we having this debate when this legislation specifically doesn't apply to Scotland? You see, actually, presiding officer, well, I have the explanatory notes here. And the explanatory notes say, and the member can look it up, I'll pass this over after if she wishes, page 3, paragraph 9, the matters to which the provisions of the Act relate are not within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament. If there are amendments relating to matters within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament, the consent of the relevant devolved legislator will be sought. Give me 2 seconds. In fact, to make this apply, because I think the Minister may want to reconsider her intervention, to any of the 6 services set out in the new section 234B, number 4, this Act specifically creates a power, which it then gives to the Scottish Government to either bring it in or not. Now, we know from the many reports today, and indeed the Cabinet Secretary's comments, that the Scottish Government has explicitly stated it does not wish to use this power, and that is its prerogative. But it is odd to see the Scottish Government rail against being given new powers, and yet somehow argue that that offends devolution. And I think the second question that many people will have concerns about is the SNP's apparently contradictory position when it comes to Europe. You see, this government has, since the UK left the European Union, made very clear that it disagrees with the UK on many things and prefers to align with the laws of the European Union. In this way, it believes that a Scotland divorced from the UK could become part of that European Union. However, let me make the point, Daniel Johnson. However, I've got my hands on the House of Commons Library's research briefing, which details how the European Union countries deal with minimum service laws. And what is clear is that whilst, like the UK, most countries recognise the fundamental right to strike, most European countries go further on minimum service levels than the UK has done with this Act, far from the global outlier that the Minister suggests. Daniel Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm grateful to Liam Kerr for giving me, but does he not recognise he's, I think, misrepresenting what alignment means? Alignment means aligning with European directives, not with kind of European practices per se. And he's deliberately, I just would wonder if he would reflect that that's not what alignment means in the formal sense.
Liam Kerr.
Well, I'm actually quoting directly from the House of Commons Library and from the Act. And I think what was interesting there was seeing that Daniel Johnson now doesn't actually want to compete for Westminster. He appears to want to join the SNP and make their points for them. Indeed, Mr. Johnson, whilst the UK Act only covers the 6 categories set out in Section 234B4, other countries commonly include the armed forces, the police, judges, public prosecutors, certain categories of civil servants. And the House of Commons Library document also shows us that where minimum service levels do exist, their breadth and extent also vary. In Italy, there are regulations during strikes in several public services which are far more extensive. In Latvia, the 1998 strike law details further sectors far more extensive than anything in the UK Act. So, presiding officer, I actually entirely understand the Labour Party's position against this Act. It seems to me that it's born of a consistent philosophical positioning around trade unions, strikes, and their views as to the role of strikes and the necessity, in their eyes, of compromising the public to achieve their ends. I might not agree with it, but I respect that it's a legitimate ideological debate. They have made clear that should they form the next UK government, they will repeal this Act. But what I find puzzling, indeed faintly ridiculous, is the SNP's vitriol and fury, given that this is surely a matter for their MPs, and given the apparent serious contradictions with both the devolution settlement and their own position on Europe. Some may very well conclude, therefore, that this is less about the right to strike and more about distracting from the very serious problems that afflict Scotland under the SNP and which are entirely within this Parliament's purview. And the only sensible thing to do, therefore, is support the amendment in Murdo Fraser's name.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I now call Bill Kidd to be followed by Monica Lennon. Around 6 minutes, Mr Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Look, the right to strike is central to a modern and free society, one that approaches industrial relations in a progressive and inclusive manner, with cooperation and compromise seen as essential strengths rather than weaknesses. Unfortunately, this has been eroded under successive UK governments. In 1997, as part of his election campaign when courting a right-wing vote, Tony Blair proudly announced, "Changes we propose would leave British law the most restrictive on trade unions in the Western world." A pledge he duly delivered on, with restrictive measures which included the imposition of an arbitrary 40% threshold for yes votes in workplace ballots on union representation. The same requirement which had wrecked Scottish devolution 20 years previously and which would have done the same to both Welsh devolution and the London Mayor. Certainly not something that Labour members should be proud of, and indeed most Labour supporters whom I know aren't proud of. However, history has a habit of repeating itself, and with a list of abandoned promises, Sir Keir Starmer does not inspire any real hope that he will be allowed to follow his party. His party will be told what to do, no matter what they pass here. Though, on the proposed commitments outlined in today's Labour motion, only recently Sir Keir lavished praise on Margaret Thatcher, who vowed to crush the unions, and so much misery and hardship was followed by many. The proposed UK strikes minimum service levels bill is, in context, another example of the UK government's lurch to the right and their increasingly unhinged approach to governance. The party, which until recently prided itself in being the party of law and order, has shown that its flouting of international law through its unlawful failed Rwanda plan, and it is failed because it's not happened, it's not gone, and its attempts to introduce new law to circumvent international human rights that is increasingly unfit to govern. The proposed anti-strike laws have been flagged by the UK's Joint Committee on Human Rights as also potentially unlawful, with others going as far to suggest that the law would amount to forced labour. The new law would let employers give a work notice that will identify the persons required to work. If workers fail to comply, they can be fired, even during a good faith trade dispute to prevent pay cuts, and the union can be sued into bankruptcy. This will be the first time that could happen since 1906. The right to fair pay and collective action are inalienable rights enshrined in the Universal Declaration that followed the Second World War and further cemented in the International Bill of Rights of 1966. These were enacted to ensure that workers faced with authoritarian employers and governments could always do the one thing. They could just say, no, if you don't pay us properly, we won't work. And this is an important point, as historically, strikes helped bring down the Iron Curtain. They forced the British Empire to abandon India, and they finished apartheid in South Africa. The right to strike is essential to a functioning democracy, and any backsliding on this opens the doors to authoritarian and repressive policies and regimes. What we've seen recently under the UK government is a slide towards a more authoritarian and repressive set of policies with blatant disregard to international law, the voice of the people, and basic decency to those fleeing persecution. And the shocking news of the recent death on the Bibby Stockholm barge reminds us all of the tragic consequences of the direction of these policies. In contrast, the Scottish Government has called for a progressive approach to relations with trade unions and has been crystal clear that it will not cooperate with establishing any minimum service order here in Scotland. We have committed to putting workers' rights at the heart of our economic programme through the Fair Work programme, and the next few years will be critical to ensuring we make the progress needed to achieve the vision for Scotland to be a leading fair work nation by 2025 and meet the changing needs of our economy and workforce. This is despite the considerable challenges faced by the EU exit, the COVID-19 pandemic, the ongoing impacts of the war in Ukraine and the current cost of living crisis. So let us be clear, if we want a government that will stand up for workers' rights, build a fair society and treat those fleeing persecution with compassion and dignity, then the choice is the SNP government, as opposed to the indifferent, heartless, pseudo and real right-wing alternatives offered by Westminster. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Monica Lennon to be followed by Keith Brown, around 6 minutes. Ms Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I too refer to my register of interests as a member of the trade unions GMB and Unite, and the voluntary section of my register lists my memberships of the RMT, PCS and CWU parliamentary groups, and that I chair the Scottish Labour trade union group. These declarations keep me on the right side of the Parliament's rules, but I'm very proud to be a trade unionist like my colleagues on these benches. And I first joined a trade union as a graduate worker more than 20 years ago, and that was several years before I joined the Labour Party, because it was drilled into me from my family background and my community experience the importance of being in a trade union. And I would say to colleagues on the Tory benches, being in a trade union, it might be seen as being ideological, but trade unions are good for the economy, and smart employers and smart politicians understand that. But in my working life and where we are today, more than two decades on, I am in despair about the state of workers' rights in Britain today. Workers' rights are more precarious than any time that I remember. What kind of future will my 17-year-old daughter and her friend group have? Already they know what it's like to be on a zero-hour contract. They know that working hard and being in work is not a protective measure against poverty. They know that a college or university qualification doesn't guarantee them fair work. And like others today, I am appalled that we're having this debate, not because it's a waste of time, because there's other things that we should be talking about, because our constituents are worried. You know, we're days away from Christmas, and Liam Kerr and I have just been singing Christmas carols together. He had my Christmas festive glasses on, I've got my reindeer dress on. But for a lot of people right now, there's not a lot to be cheerful about. And many people want to see the Tories getting sacked this Christmas at Westminster. And I would like to see the Conservatives in this place maybe stand up to their colleagues. It's not always easy to do that in a political party, but don't just be an apologist. We've seen the Tories in the Scottish Parliament stand up to their colleagues at Westminster before. Maybe it's time to do it again. Because the Prime Minister may well be one of the richest men in Britain today, but his rotten government is morally bankrupt. The Tories at Westminster are out of control because they know they are on borrowed time. And what we're seeing, not just with this act, but in many, many other actions, a full frontal assault on workers' rights. So I am relieved that the Scottish Government will not enforce the Tories UK Strikes Act. It does attack the dignity and rights of public sector workers. And I was pleased to hear the Cabinet Secretary today state that fair work ambitions are the bedrock of the Scottish Government's wellbeing economy vision, or vision for the wellbeing economy. And I support that, but we all need to work harder in here to make sure that the actions that we take match that ambition. And that does mean funding our public services properly, using public procurement powers to improve workers' terms and conditions, tackling the growing disability pay gap that we see in Scotland, and tackling the rise of zero-hour contracts. And I know Claire Hawkey maybe ran out of time to take my intervention, but we didn't hear a peep out of Claire Hawkey, who's left her seat right now, when the SNP was caught using zero-hour contracts in her Rutherglen constituency during a recent by-election. Perhaps she raised that point with the SNP leadership, and I see that the Deputy Leader, Keith Brown, is here, so I'm happy to hear from Mr Brown.
Keith Brown.
Can I thank Monica Lennon for taking the intervention, and similarly, could she explain why it was the Labour Party were reported to be using hire and rehire 2 years ago for their own staff, and why North Lanarkshire proposed such changes affecting many women that Unison had to threaten strike action to make sure they avoided the hire and rehire tactics which she is currently condemning the Conservatives for?
Monica Lennon, I can give you the time back.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm not aware of all these examples that Mr Brown has given, but I'm not shy at speaking out about my own party when we don't get things right. So today isn't about keeping score, but what I am clear about is that the rise of fire and rehire practices across the country is unacceptable. I have written to the Cabinet Secretary about that. And historically, Labour and the trade unions did fall short when it came to tackling issues around gender pay gap. The Cabinet Secretary, yep.
Cabinet Secretary.
Seeking for a point of consensus, because I think on this issue, both on the opposition to the Minimum Services Act, there is consensus between the Scottish Labour Party and ourselves. And the point that previously was made by Monica Lennon around using public procurement, for instance, would you accept that there has been progress made, indeed just this year, in further enhancing the Fair Work First principles to ensure that fair work conditionality is applied to public sector grants, such as ensuring the real living wage and worker voice are applied to those grant-making tasks?
Monica Lennon, and again, I can give you the time back.
Yeah, no, I thank the Cabinet Secretary, and I do accept where progress has been made, but we must do more to strengthen fair work conditionality and to address in-work poverty. I know that many trade union colleagues are looking to see the implementation of Fair Work Convention recommendations and Fair Work Action Plan commitments on collective bargaining. I recently chaired the Scottish Labour Trade Union Group meeting with a room full of trade unionists. The agenda had about 25 items on it, and most of that was about issues here in Scotland. So I am being robust about the Tory government, but we need to do better. And that also means that local government and other public sector employers too. We've heard a lot of references today to the House of Commons library, and I'm sure there's very important reading material there. But I'm very concerned that the Tory amendment, I see Liam Kerr's waving at me, but I know that the Tory amendment is really trying to provide cover for the UK government. But let's not be apologists. We also know that one of the committees at the UK Parliament has called this out. The UK Parliament's Joint Committee on Human Rights, which stated in no uncertain terms that the UK government, quote, has not adequately made the case that this bill meets the UK's human rights obligations, end quote. So I do wish Murdo Fraser well, recovering from his injury, but there's a lot of cherry picking going on to try and make out that somehow Tory Britain is a leader when it comes to workers' rights, when we know it absolutely is not the case. I've taken a couple of interventions, so time is now short. I know there was time in hand, Presiding Officer. So just to conclude by saying, this is a tough time in the country with cost of living crisis and for workers. Christmas is not going to be a peaceful and joyful time for many of our constituents. But union-busting governments won't win. As Ros Foyer, the STC General Secretary, has said, workers will not be turned into slaves. We know that trade unions are the last line of defence for workers and communities. That's why we stand by them. And I think the message from this place today needs to be, we have to get the Tories out of Downing Street as soon as possible. It's vital for workers, for the economy, and it's in the national interests.
Thank you, Ms Lennon. I now call Keith Brown to be followed by Maggie Chapman, around 6 minutes. Mr Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just to go back to a couple of the strongest themes of this debate. First of all, the Conservative approach, which is to say this doesn't really affect Scotland. Why are we even discussing it? Well, the reason is, I think Monica Lennon put her finger on it when she talked about the underfunding of public services. If you have a piece of legislation coming through which will enable the suppression of wages in the rest of the UK, that has a direct consequence in Scotland, and it increases the pace at which the Tories have run down our public services in this country. That is why it's extremely relevant. And already, yes, I'll give way to Brian Whittle.
Brian Whittle.
Very grateful to Keith Brown for giving way. How on earth can you take this legislation and say that's going to suppress wage rises in the rest of the United Kingdom? That is absolutely fundamental nonsense.
Keith Brown.
I imagine Brian Whittle must be the only person in the chamber that can't see the link by restricting trade unions' ability to strike and the suppression of wages. But maybe if he goes away and researches a bit, he'll work it out. There has been a great deal of talk over many years, of course, about legislation surrounding trade unions in the UK, more often than not caused by the UK government over the day, bringing forward legislation or failing to repeal legislation, which actively seeks to curtail the effectiveness of trade unions, as is also the case with this piece of legislation. I speak as somebody who was a trade union member for many years, a branch officer and shop steward, who went on strike during the Thatcher years, but against a Labour employer, I should say, at that time in 1989. And I think it's very important to recognise, and I don't want to look necessarily for points of difference between ourselves and the Labour Party, but it is important to explain, I think, why Claire Hawhey is not filled with trust from the Labour Party. It was the Labour Party, as I said, that we had to campaign against and strike against in 1989. It was the Labour Party that made huge commitments initially in the 90s to repeal the Tory legislation, some very far-reaching Tory legislation, and in many cases failed to do that, which again has led to that loss in support. And I think many of us have dealt with Labour employers over the years. I remember being threatened by an ex-member of this chamber for my trade union activities, threatened with legal action because of my trade union activities. I remember my own trade union, Unison, encouraging Labour members to spy on SNP councillors and click back to a certain area. So there is a long history of lack of... I'm not so sure what's bothering Brian. I don't know if Brian Whittle knows which debate he's actually in. So there is a long history of distrust, and I think there is some merit in trying to overcome that distrust. Now, it was asked earlier on by Michael Marra whether it should be the case that the SNP should support Labour's stated intention. I was asked repeatedly in 2014-2015 to not proceed with the biggest contract which the Scottish Government lets, which is the ScotRail contract, because Labour would be on the second and they would sort it all out so we didn't have to do it. That was 8 years ago. We still don't have a Labour government. And nobody believes, given Keir Starmer's track record, they will actually stay true to what they're saying just now. All of that means, I think, that the trade unions who we currently have are in a very difficult situation. They have been now for some years. But it's also true to say that if you look at the actions of the Scottish Government, that is the way to deal with trade unions. Get into a discussion, have the discussion where it's possible to do so, to compromise, but crucially recognise the role of trade unions and how they can help in terms of providing public services. I will do, yes.
Monica Lennon.
I'm grateful to Keith Brown for giving way. The Labour amendment adds to the government motion. I think that's very constructive. I think it shows there's a lot of agreement, and it's simply asking to support Labour's New Deal for working people. And I think a message from this Parliament reinforces what we want colleagues down the road to do. So is there a problem? Is the member going to be voting against that tonight?
Keith Brown.
I've just tried to explain and what I've just said why there is very little trust if what the Labour Party says it intends to do. I've explained that a number of times. I should also say that strong trade unions are probably needed more now than they have been for many years, because it's pretty obvious to any working person in Scotland or the UK just how much poorer their paying conditions are now compared to just a few years ago. We know that wages have been largely stagnant in the UK for the past 15 years, while the cost of living has soared beyond all belief. According to the Resolution Foundation, an independent think tank focusing on the improved on the living standards of low to middle income workers in the UK, the average UK household is now £11,000 worse off in real terms than it was in 2008. But when we look to comparable countries like France and Germany, we can see the typical French household is 11% richer, or typical German household 27% richer than the typical family in the UK, again, according to the Resolution Foundation. And on this, I'm happy to apportion the blame where it deserves to be, which is, of course, the 14 years of failed austerity that we've had from the Conservative parties. But most European countries, including France and Germany, have a far better, more collegiate approach to trade unions than the UK does. And that's reflected in the increasingly worsening living standards in the UK. The Tories are responsible for the biggest fall in living standards in living memory. That's an appalling record for them to preside over. It's my view that precisely because of the continual strengthening of anti-trade union legislation, why are they focusing on that? Why do they always focus on taking away people's rights? Whether it's trans people, whether it's refugees, or in this case, whether it's trade union workers. Why are they always pandering to their base? And I mean the word base in both its senses. They're base in trying to attack people and indulging in culture wars. The latest one, this proposal, the Strikes Minimum Services Level Act, is just the latest in a line of anti-trade union legislation because they think it appeals to their base supporters. Just to remind the Chamber that Scotland has not voted for the Conservative Party or any of the earlier iterations of it since 1955. And in this coming election, which has been mentioned already, Scotland will actually have less representatives in Westminster than it does now, down to 57 from 59, whilst England, of course, will have 10 more. And that means that as a country, we are even less able to stop legislation like this. And the Labour Party has to wrestle. Daniel Johnson said that we should indulge in some self-analysis and reflection. If Labour were to get in next year, if they repeal that, two big ifs, what is to stop in 2 or 3 years' time after that, going back to the same base Tory party that gets in once again, the usual ding-dong of UK politics and workers again in Scotland having to pay the price for being part of the union? That's what we're trying to avoid here. And it's just about the very last nail in the coffin that we have in terms of the UK's conduct of our affairs. And just to say that the statements by Keir Starmer in relation to Margaret Thatcher, this admiration for Margaret Thatcher that he has, one thing that worries me is the fact that we passed in this chamber the Miners' Pardon Bill. And at that point, was various commitments made by the Labour Party to say if they ever formed a government, they would go further. They would provide that pardon across the UK and they would look at compensation for those miners, given the fact the UK government took over £4 billion from miners' pension funds. I really doubt whether Keir Starmer would even look at increasing the protections or the compensation for miners. And that's why I think it's very important that we support the motion today, because in the absence of the powers necessary to change the law, we have to be absolutely clear our opposition as a parliament to this act, and we can show what we would do differently if the powers over employment law were held here in this chamber. So for that reason, Presiding Officer, I support the motion in the name of Neil Gray.
Thank you, Mr Brown. As I indicated before, there is a bit of time in hand. If somebody wants to make an intervention, I'd encourage them to do that rather than shout it from a sedentary position. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Evan McKee. Around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I refer members to my register of interests. I'm a member of Unite the Union and a consultative member of the Aberdeen Trades Union Council. Our public services across health, transport, fire and rescue, education and so much more are the lifeblood of our communities and the bedrock of our society. We all rely on them every day, whether we acknowledge them or not. And of course, these services do not appear by magic, staffed and supported by fairies or elves. No, these vital public services only exist because of the hundreds of thousands of people across Scotland that dedicate their lives to the service of their and our communities. Our nurses, firefighters, bus drivers, train conductors, teaching assistants, indeed all who work in our life-sustaining public services, deserve our admiration and thanks. But more than that, they deserve each and every one of us elected to represent them to fight for their rights and conditions. The Strikes Minimum Service Levels Act 2023 and associated statutory instruments drive not a cart and horses, but a freight train through that. Lawyers, trade union activists, academics, indeed people from across civic society are clear. This legislation undermines the fundamental rights of workers, most notably their right to withdraw their labour, as Daniel Johnson and others have highlighted this afternoon. It disrupts the often delicate conditions in industrial relations. It runs contrary to the principles of fair work, and it adversely affects not only the workers, but their wider communities and our broad commitments to social justice. Scottish Greens are clear, workers' rights and their empowerment are fundamental to social justice. By mandating minimum service levels during strikes, the legislation restricts the ability of workers to effectively voice their concerns and negotiate better working conditions. It also effectively discourages alternative dispute resolution mechanisms that prioritise dialogue and negotiation over legal restrictions. It sets up a much more adversarial and much less collaborative approach to collective bargaining. And collective bargaining is a cornerstone of modern labour relations. Any law that limits the right to strike or other options of dispute resolution diminishes the bargaining power of workers. This can lead to even more unequal power dynamics between employers and employees than already exist. Favouring the interests of the powerful over those who work for them will only perpetuate inequalities. Indeed, I believe that strong workers' rights are essential for building a fair and just society. Rather than ensuring continuity of essential services and safeguarding the interests of the public, this legislation we debate today has the potential to destroy constructive and productive relationships between workers and their bosses. And if we remember that public sector workers are also members of the public, it undermines trust in government and legislators. The burden of employment and maintaining services should not fall so heavily on the backs of workers. Workers should not have to shoulder the responsibility for upholding the public good, often at the expense of their own well-being and job satisfaction. And the Act's negative impact extends beyond the workplace, reaching into communities. By suppressing the collective voice of workers, the legislation weakens the ability of communities to advocate for fair labour practices and inclusive economic policies. Healthy communities thrive on the equitable distribution of resources and opportunities, and any legislation that weakens the position of workers undermines the social fabric that binds communities together. This Act could negatively affect local communities and their needs, undermining the principle that decisions that affect communities should be made collectively. Many, including the Scottish Trades Union Congress, believe that this legislation contradicts the very essence of democratic principles. Democracy thrives on the participation and representation of all citizens, including workers, in decision-making processes. Limiting the ability of workers to voice their concerns through strikes diminishes their participation in shaping the policies that directly affect their lives. So this legislation clearly comes into conflict with the principles of social justice, solidarity, and equality. And of course, social justice seeks to create a society where all individuals enjoy fair and equal opportunities, and workers' rights are fundamental to that pursuit. By restricting the right to strike, the Act perpetuates inequalities and hampers the progress towards that more just and equitable society. So I was pleased to hear last month the Cabinet Secretary say that he did not believe such legislation had any place in a forward-looking country that seeks to build a fairer and more equal society. And I agree with much in the Labour amendment. Scottish Greens are clear. Not only are fair work principles intrinsic to our vision for a compassionate and caring economy, but we also vehemently oppose the use of zero-hour contracts, fire and rehire practices, and the other appalling practices mentioned in the Labour amendment. However, I share some of Claire Hockey's distrust of the Westminster Labour Party. After all, they had 13 years under Blair and Brown to undo all of Thatcher's anti-trade union laws. And they could have ensured that we could be improving workers' rights in Scotland now, had they not vetoed the devolution of employment law during the Smith Commission. I was just about to conclude, but if I'll take
a very brief amendment, Mr. Murray.
I appreciate the member giving way. Does she not think, given that her own mistrust in the Labour Party, wouldn't it be best to vote for the amendment and put that extra pressure on the Labour Party to make sure that we deliver this? If it's a set of reasons that you agree with, then surely you should vote for
it. I think we've got the gist. Maggie Chapman?
I think it's very, very clear that whoever governs Westminster hasn't needed Scotland's support for a long time, and I'd rather be focused our efforts on what we can deliver here in Scotland. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, this debate matters to us here in Scotland because workers' rights should always matter to us. And I express my solidarity with those workers elsewhere in the UK who will be negatively affected by this legislation. We should be standing up against any laws that undermine the principles of democratic participation and fair labour practices. These must be central to any socially just society. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Chapman. I now call Ivan McKee to be followed by Carol Morgan. Mr. McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to speak on this debate this afternoon. And I think it's important, first of all, to recognise what this debate is about and what this legislation is about, because it's primarily, of course, an attack on workers' rights. And Claire Hawley has very well laid out the history of Tory government attacks on trade union rights over many, many decades. It seeks to undermine legitimate trade union activity, and it doesn't respect the fair work principles that are, of course, so central to the Scottish Government's approach to building a fairer and more successful economy. But it's also, of course, an attack on devolution, impacting, as it does, on devolved areas, as has been highlighted
by the government front bench and others. And I do commend the Scottish Government's position in not cooperating with establishing any minimum service orders that may come to pass as a consequence of this legislation. I think it's important to recognise where we are. Front bench have been made clear the UK's record in terms of having a higher prevalence of low pay, longer working hours, lower statutory sick pay and many, many other negative indicators compared to other independent European countries. And this, of course, has led directly, I believe, to a lower growth and a lower productivity economy. And Scotland, of course, as has been highlighted, missing out on EU workers' rights enhancements due to the Tory party's hard Brexit. Meanwhile, in Scotland, we've got an approach that seeks to avoid public sector strikes and work very constructively with trade unions, because trade unions are, of course, a key part of the democratic fabric of Scotland's Scottish society and have been for obviously for a very, very long time. And it's important that we build on that as partners, taking forward that critically important fair work agenda. Recognising, as the government does, and I was delighted to be part of this when I was a minister, enshrining or including trade union representatives in the work we do with various sectors through the industry leadership group. And this is something that's been recognised by that partnership by Keith Brown and others through the course of the discussion we've had this afternoon. Delighted also that others have highlighted the fact that the importance of trade unions is not just in a domestic setting, but in the international setting. And Bill Kidd highlighted some hugely critical examples of why trade unions are absolutely essential part of the democratic fabric of our society. And also critically important to recognise the hugely important role that public sector workers and other workers in key sectors of the economy do to support all of us, particularly at this time of year, and the critical importance of trade unions in supporting the work that they do, highlighted by Maggie Chapman, Monica Lennon and others, and important to recognise the attack that this bill brings to bear on those rights. It's really important also then to recognise where we want to get to. And the Scottish Government has been clear the economy we want to build here is something that's based on high wages, leading to high productivity, and high innovation, an economy strong in the industries of the future, absolutely focused on working with trade unions and working with workers across all those sectors, public and private industry, to be able to build that economy. Because that link between treating workers well, having high wages and enshrining high conditions for workers' rights within the economy and within legislation is absolutely a critical part, an element that needs to be recognised of building that high productivity economy. And again, this legislation seeks to attack and lead to the detriment of that. So in conclusion, presiding officer, recognising what needs to happen next. Clearly, the Scottish Government's approach in resisting this legislation is absolutely to be welcomed and supported. It's absolutely critical that we work to secure the devolution of employment law to this Parliament, something we've debated in this chamber on many occasions, an area where the Scottish Labour's position is ambiguous, to say the least, and really unhelpful, and with them not coming out and taking forward a very clear position demanding that future UK Labour government, as a matter of priority, were that to happen, would devolve employment law so that we could have the standards enshrined in the Scottish Parliament in future, regardless of what may happen going forward in Westminster. Delighted to.
Michael Mara.
Can the member then make clear his support for the repeal of this legislation and the New Deal for Working People, his support, by voting for our amendment tonight? Make that clear.
Ivan McKee.
It's been very clear by Keith Brown and other members today, Claire Haughey and others, that frankly we don't trust the Labour Party to deliver on that. And that the only way to secure those rights is for Labour to support devolution of employment law, and of course for us to secure the full powers as a normal independent country as soon as possible. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
I now call Carol Mockin to be followed by Liz Smith. Ms Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I refer members to my register of interest as a member of Unite the Union and, of course, as a lifelong activist in the trade union movement. I join the majority of Parliament to condemn this disgraceful piece of legislation. We should be united in our opposition to cheap power grabs and speak with one voice against the UK government's increasingly hostile and archaic agenda against workers. Presiding officer, I am sure it won't be long before the Scottish public let them know exactly what they think of this and the dreadful way in which they treat the ordinary people of this country. Trying to stifle legitimate democratic engagement and workers' representation across the UK is the kind of thing you would expect from an authoritarian government desperate to cling on to power. Presiding officer, I fear that's not far off what Sunak's Tories really are. The public will speak in 2024. Trying to force through unworkable and unjust legislation is not going to change that. If the Tories think the problems in our society are caused by trade unions simply asking for a fair deal for their workers, then they are not opening their eyes at all. Public services, our health services, our railways are seriously underfunded. All of this is a smokescreen to stop you noticing the problems within our society caused by this dreadful UK Tory government. We cannot ban our way out of productivity and healthcare crises. You have to build something with the people who work in those fields. Build something with them by your side. I wholeheartedly agree with the Scottish Government that this legislation is designed to undermine legitimate trade union activity. In fact, I would go further. Its intention is to destroy it and ensure that generations to come do not have effective trade union representation whatsoever. This is why I'm pleased the Scottish Government assured us today that there will be no minimum service level agreements or work notices in Scotland, and this commitment is very welcome. I'm sure particularly by ScotRail and Caledonian Sleeper, important services owned and controlled by the Scottish Government. Now, here in Scotland, we have a proud and noble history of workers' struggles. And it is a struggle. It is a struggle. That's why it's called the struggle. It is a struggle sometimes within our own movement, as has been discussed today. But the struggle pushes us to go further, and it pushes us to come together as trade unionists. So I am standing here, and I am asking the trade unionists in the benches opposite to come together on this issue. We have stood together in other times. On picket lines, we have stood together to ensure workers' rights can be upheld. And if there's a chance that we can do that, we stand on that. So I ask you to support the Scottish Labour amendment this evening. Of course.
Keith Brown.
Can I appreciate the first of all the fact that Karen Watkins taken intervention and for the reasonable tone that she's adopted, but can she understand the point that SNP members are trying to make, which is that regardless of what any Labour government might do, that can change as soon as another Conservative government gets elected. Unless you can guarantee there'll never be another Tory government that will not also repeal this legislation, that is why we should be devolving this, so it will always be in the hands of this Parliament at the very least.
Karen Watkins.
Thank you. I thank Keith Brown for the intervention. I'm doing this from the heart. I'm asking you, you know, if I was to stand here and take the position of asking you about every single thing that your front bench have not delivered on, then we would never move forward. This is a moment in time where this Scottish Parliament can say to the UK Parliament, trade unionists are united on this and we believe in the information that is in the Fair Work Principles that Scottish Labour are saying we will fight tooth and nail to get in the first 100 days of a Labour government. Back the New Deal tonight. Show where you stand as trade unionists. Is strewn into the very, you know, the workers' struggle is strewn into the very fabric of our nation. And as for as long as there is a Labour Party, as long as there are trade unionists, as long as that movement is there, we will continue to be the cornerstone working together of that progress. Yes, progress if we work together as trade unionists. The results of allowing legislation like this to take hold is simply a transfer of power from those with the least to those with the most. It's a green light to cut wages and benefits in key sectors and begin an absolute race to the bottom. It is about the rich taking from the poor. And if we want to fight that, we need to take every opportunity to back things that might actually cause that. Freedom for the rich whilst the poor know their place. That's what the Tories want. Let's come together. Let's stand as the Scottish Parliament. Let's stand as trade unions together and back Labour tonight, their amendment in the New Deal for working people within the first 100 days of a Labour government, which would repeal the terrible legislation that we have from this awful Tory government. The New Deal for working people is described by the TUC as the biggest expansion in workers' rights in decades. I ask you to support the amendment this evening so that we can change the outcomes for those hard-working families that have been hammered since 2010. And I ask you for the last time to back the amendment. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Morgan. And I now call Liz Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I put on the parliamentary record that in my previous life, before I was elected to this place, albeit some time ago, it has to be said, I was a member of a trade union, the Scottish Secondary Teachers Association, because I believe that unions have a vital role to play. So I don't accept that Tories are anti-trade unions. Now, this issue is all about seeking the right balance between the democratic right to strike and maintaining public services, most especially those that are providing essential and emergency services. Now, it's a complex and delicate balance, but it's also an important one. On the one hand, the right to strike is a fundamental labour right which allows workers to collectively voice their grievances and negotiate for better working conditions, wages and benefits. In other words, it's a crucial tool for workers to exert pressure on employers and ensure that their rights are protected. And on the other hand, as we all know, public services are essential for the functioning of the economy and society, most especially the well-being of its citizens, whether that's healthcare, education, transport, or emergency services. And whilst we all accept that strikes inevitably mean disruption, we have seen in recent times that the scale of these disruptions to essential services have had particularly severe consequences impacting the general public, vulnerable populations and, of course, the economy as a whole. I won't, if you don't mind. And to achieve the right balance, many countries have established legal frameworks that regulate the right to the strike in the context of the public services. And as Murdo Fraser rightly said in his opening remarks, he gave some examples from these other countries, pointing out that the frameworks may differ, but they also include restrictions such as mandatory negotiation periods, minimum service requirements, and arbitration mechanisms. And collectively, these measures aim to secure that the essential services are maintained to a certain extent during the strikes, minimising the impact on the public. And additionally, as several other members have stated, dialogue and negotiation between unions, workers, and employers are absolutely crucial in finding compromises that address workers' concerns whilst minimising disruption to public services. Open communication channels, mediation and alternative dispute resolution methods actually help to facilitate that process, even if it takes time. But sometimes they fail, and that is what this issue is all about in this debate. We know how many working days have been lost both last year, and I'm sure the same statistics will emerge for this year. And I'm not going to rehearse the examples of a very small minority of striking individuals deliberately choosing to obstruct blue light services from accessing emergency sites. I've had a constituent who was suffered as a result of that, or to those who choose to bring transport networks to a complete standstill, or to those who choose to cut off and willfully damage energy networks. But these are quite clearly situations which have a very considerable impact on the public, rather than those with whom the strikers are in dispute. And that, as far as the public is concerned, is inexcusable. So at its very simplest level, the Strikes Minimum Services Act is designed to ensure that there is a necessary level of services being maintained when protesters are exercising their democratic rights. Yes, I'm sure.
Minister Marie Todd.
Just on that issue of, for example, in the healthcare service in England, there have been 125,000 outpatient appointments cancelled, inpatient procedures cancelled, nearly a million outpatient appointments cancelled. That is incredible harm. The public are not cross with the striking workers for that. The public are furious that the UK government have let the dispute get to the stage where people have to withdraw their labour. There have been no strikes of that scale in Scotland because this government is willing to negotiate and work in partnership with our healthcare worker unions.
Liz Smith?
Well, because of GDPR, Minister, I'm not at liberty to show you some of the correspondence with one of my constituents who I'm afraid would have a very different point of view from what you have just stated. Now, sorry?
Excuse me, Ms Smith, please resume your seat for a second. If a member wishes to participate in the debate, they know how to do that, and it is not from a sedentary position. Liz Smith, please continue.
I do think that for the SNP, this debate seems to be their usual line, that everything that emanates from Westminster has to be wrong and opposed. And I'm afraid I struggle with the assertion that the Act undermines devolution, because the legislation relates to areas of reserved matters which affect Scotland. Colleagues have mentioned border security, nuclear decommissioning, passports, but as several people have now said, it does not impact on the devolved responsibility, since the Scottish Government is not obliged to mandate minimum service levels. And my colleague Liam Kerr read out that legislation, the notes that accompany that. So the argument that it is undermining devolution simply doesn't hold water. And I think I'm in my last bit. And finally, as a result of what I've just said above, we really should be concentrating on some of the issues in devolved politics, which, whether the SNP like it or not, there is a long list of critical challenges, just like the education debate which took place in Conservative time yesterday. So, as far as I'm concerned, this debate is unfortunate in many ways, but it is about getting the right balance between the democratic right to strike and ensuring that there is a provision of essential services. And I, quite frankly, don't see how anyone would oppose that.
Thank you, Ms Smith. And before we move to closing speeches, I note that we are missing two members, one of whom is the Cabinet Secretary. It is discourteous for those who have participated in a debate not to be present for closing speeches. And I hope I receive an apology from both members concerned. And I call on Michael Mara to close on behalf of Scottish Labour. Mr Mara.
Thank you, President Officer. I hope the Cabinet Secretary has not felt necessary to withdraw his labour at this moment in the proceedings. Let's be clear, and I think there is widespread agreement on most of the Chamber that this is a really atrocious piece of legislation emanating from the Tory government in Westminster. And I think most of us recognise exactly why they are doing it. It is just an attempt to distract from what is a dreadful record on the economy and public services across the UK. And with a general election on the horizon, the Tories know they have nothing positive whatsoever to offer this country. None of this is really, Presiding Officer, about the safe operation of public services in this country. And as Daniel Johnson pointed out, the approach simply doesn't work. We know that. More days are lost to industrial action in countries which have these provisions than in the UK today. And it was a Tory adviser that has told us that these provisions promise more strikes than they mitigate. Because, of course, already trade unions already put in place agreements and arrangements to ensure that when exercising their basic human rights and withdrawing their labour in order to protect, and that's what they're doing, the safe delivery of Lifeline public services, they have agreements to make sure that Lifeline services are protected in this country. And this, really, this legislation is part of what is an incessant attempt to draw Labour into culture war dividing lines that pit one part of our country against another, sowing division and hatred with manufactured controversies in order to do anything, anything at all, to distract from their disastrous record of incompetence, corruption and party division. So I would cite getting the woke out of academia, a made-up war on motorists, fictitious taxes on meat, the seven deadly bins, the war on tofu and on chai lattes, the despicable and now farcical Rwanda policy, the Prime Minister's confected and infantile tantrum over the Elgin Marbles, summoning a far-right mob to the cenotaph when we are remembering our dead. Is there no depth, presiding officer, to which this Conservative government will not sink? No issue of respect, of decency, that remains sacrosanct in their desperate attempts to change the conversation from their economic vandalism and the shockingly weak leadership of a Prime Minister waiting now to be put out of misery by the electorate if his own party doesn't get him first. And in contrast to all of this, it was right of Bill Kidd to remind us and this chamber of the moral contribution of trade unions, such as fighting apartheid in South Africa. And I would also commend Keith Brown, MSP, for what I thought was a single very important contribution in his speech. The reminder that the suppression of wages in the UK due to Tory austerity lessens the bargaining power of workers in Scotland in their fight for trade, for better wages from this government and against private companies as well. In essence, the attacks on workers anywhere is attack on workers everywhere. That is a fundamental premise of what trade unionism is about. I am afraid that at that point, I think that Mr Brown's contribution went downhill somewhat. And I have to say that it's the one major point of this, that I think it's fundamental for the SNP to understand, that the struggle for workers' rights is never won. It's not won by one piece of legislation. It has to be re-won every single day. It's why we are members of trade unions. And I proudly remind the Chamber of my register of interests as a trade union member since I was able to join. Yes, sir.
Keith Brown.
Can I thank Michael Marra for taking the intervention? And will he just acknowledge the point I'm trying to make? He's right to say it's never won, but it's surely much more secure if this Parliament has the powers over these issues, so they can't simply be trumped by the election of another Tory government in the future. Why can't he just support that, as the Labour Party used to do a few months ago?
Michael Marra.
I would remind Mr Brown that, I mean, there's not everybody in this country is immune to the appeal of right-wing populism. I don't think you have to look very far from the recent split in his own party and the emergence of ALBA as to what the appeal of some of these people can be. There are people who take these views, no matter what you might like or object to, and this in a democracy is a struggle that has to be re-won time and time again. And independence is no salve to that. It's an argument that will have to be made and won by progressive parties in this country until we run out of democracy, and we'll be tied, all of us, if that were to be the case. So I would say then that you have to consider, and I thought it was a very timely and impassioned, typically impassioned contribution from Carl Mochen to talk about, actually, to endorse the position of the TUC and the STUC, talking about the transformative, the generational transformative nature of Labour's proposed New Deal for working people. And I would say to members of the Green Party and the SNP, genuinely, if you want to support something, you have to vote for it. If you want this legislation repealed, then you're going to have to vote for a government that's going to do it. I would say to them that you have to exert pressure. If you don't trust the Labour Party, tell us in this vote today why you should, what we should be doing. You say that these are things you believe in, then good God, vote for them. Vote for the Labour amendment tonight. Because I would also say the governing party, presiding officer, does have much work to do when we talk about fair work. Despite the government committing to be making Scotland a leading fair work nation by 2025, the Fair Work Convention just last month described Scotland's performance as mixed, I quote. According to that same convention, Scotland ranks 5th out of 9 of comparator small countries. Our disability employment gap is 31 percentage points, second bottom of that list of comparator countries. 29% of workers in non-permanent work are there by choice. That figure is 4% in Austria and 7% in Iceland. So much more that needs to be done by this government, by all progressive parties across the country who claim that name. Because the right to withhold one's labour is a fundamental human right, and it's essential to the fabric of our society and our economy, which depends on a healthy and safe workforce. The two things in this country that have secured the most in terms of workers' rights are the right to strike industrial action and the achievements that have been won under Labour governments. And those freedoms are hard fought for and hard won. Trade unions and the Labour movement more broadly have an unrelenting task in holding back that Tory tide of anti-worker policies.
Mr Marr, I hope you're concluding.
I will conclude, Presiding Officer. On that basis, I would say that the position that the Tories take and their amendment, I think, is spurious, and I beg, I really implore the people on these benches, and the SNP and the Greens, to vote for what they claim they believe in.
Yes. Thank you, Mr Marr. I now call on Brian Whittle to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Mr Whittle.
Deputy Presiding Officer. This has been a debate with lots of sound and fury, but not a lot of substance. Of course, that's what the SNP were probably aiming for, because sound and fury is good if you're trying to cover the deafening silence on how the Scottish Government proposed to deal with the abysmal PISA scores, an NHS in crisis, and years of economic mismanagement coming home to roost. Myrtle Fraser and Liam Kerr forensically dismantled the Cabinet Secretary's position and quite frankly made this debate the farce that it actually is, because today is just another example of the SNP filling the void of competence with righteous indignation, leaving opposition benches to bring forward devolved topics, as highlighted by Liam Kerr. But turning to the subject of today's debate, I don't propose to spend much time highlighting how disingenuous the SNP motion is, not least of all because my colleagues, Myrtle Fraser and Leo Kerr, have already done this. But it does seem to me that the SNP are attempting to out-Labour Labour. And as Liam Kerr noted, at least Labour are consistent in their approach, however much we may think they are flawed. I do think, however, that we need to draw a distinction in this discussion between workers' rights and trade union powers, because they aren't the same, even if it benefits some to suggest that they are. So let's be clear. The Scottish Conservatives support workers' rights, as do all Conservatives. The first health and safety measures for working with machinery, the decriminalisation of trade union liability and legalising of picketing, the introduction of paid holidays and the rights against unfair dismissal are all a few of the improvements to workers' rights brought in by Conservative governments. This legislation is not about eroding workers' rights. It's about ensuring that everyone, workers and all, can still rely on a basic level of essential public services during industrial disputes. It's about ensuring that when the trade union takes forward the nuclear option of strike action, the disruption caused is not disproportionate. We're not talking about banning strike action. We're talking about reducing the potential for indirect harms as a result of strike action. Deputy Presiding Officer, of course, there is a hugely important place for trade unions in Scotland to stand up for workers and, when necessary, take forward strike action. But the debate we're having on this issue is driven by the Scottish Government's unwillingness to do anything that risks upsetting trade unions. The nature of relations between employer and employee always comes with a certain level of tension and continual debate about its balance. In this case, Liz Smith said, we are talking about the balance between the right of those providing essential public services in healthcare, education, public transport to strike, and the right of the wider public to expect those public services to be available when they need them. Strike action is, at its most basic level, a tool of leverage in negotiation. The right to deny your labour in protest at unfair treatment is one of the most basic rights any worker has, and to place restrictions on it is not something any government should do lightly. However, there has long been a recognition that the right to strike is not absolute. Police officers are not permitted to strike. Secondary strikes in sympathy with other strikes are against the law, and so on. Similarly, legislation on minimum service levels is not unique to the United Kingdom, as Myrtle Fraser and Liam Kerr have alluded to. And I do find it a strange position, as Liam Kerr said, for a Scottish government to take. Of course.
Michael Marr.
I appreciate the member giving way. Can he tell us then what has happened over the last 2 years that requires this dial to be moved further in the direction of further restrictions? What are the instances he feels where there have been harm to the public that has resulted from that industrial action?
Brian Whittle.
I don't accept that the balance has moved. The dial has moved. This is about striking a balance. We need to strike a balance, and that is always a debate that's going to be had. Yep. We're always going to have that debate. There's always a tension between that. Of course I'll give way.
Cabinet Secretary.
First of all, apologies, Presiding Officer, and I've written to yourself, and I'm in the process of writing to Mr Mara for missing the opening of his speech. But in seeking to get the balance right in response to Michael Mara, why on earth would the Conservative Party be willing to see the universal opposition that there has been from the trade union movement, not just domestically but internationally, to these bills, if this is about getting the balance right, because it's quite clearly getting the balance wrong?
Brian Whittle.
What a surprise that the trade unions are against this. What a surprise. But I'll give you a little indication, Cabinet Secretary. See, when you're doing negotiations, you have to take the contrary position sometimes. And that's something, when you're taking hard decisions and to avoid strike action. We can avoid strike action. I'm going to come on to that in a little bit, if I may, Cabinet Secretary. There are those who argue that any legislation limiting the rights of trade unions to launch strike action are unfair, that they are harmful to industrial relations. But I would argue that there is a responsibility of any government to weigh that harm against the potential harm and disruption from the loss, even temporarily, of key public services. Government, like any employer, has a balance to strike between spending on its workforce to provide good paying conditions and spending on other costs. There is a balance between decisions that benefit the short term and those that are right for the long term. No government can credibly satisfy all of the people all of the time. But in the SNP, we see a government that consistently prioritises the short-term gain, even when it stores up long-term pain. That unwillingness to make hard choices, Cabinet Secretary, for the long term has consequences for all of us. While the SNP, While the SNP have been quick to pat themselves on the back every time they avoid strike action when the rest of the UK didn't, that comes at a cost, specifically a public sector wage bill that's predicted to have risen by at least £1.7 billion more than anticipated on the back of settlements that sit well outside of the government's own public sector pay policy. Regardless of whether you believe these pay deals were at the right level or not, that is a bill that has to be paid. Whether it's a lack of willingness or a lack of ability to take a firm negotiating line with trade unions, the outcome is the same. The actions of this Scottish Government will leave the public paying the price, of course.
Cabinet Secretary, briefly.
I don't know if Mr Whittle has recognised that there has been a UK cost crisis and aspiring inflation in the UK that meant that it's absolutely right that we seek to give fair pay settlements to public sector workers, which I would have hoped Mr Whittle would have agreed is the right thing to do. But also, by giving frontline public service workers more money in their pay, it's also supporting the economy, as particularly low-paid workers spend disproportionately more in their local economies, thus supporting local businesses in their communities. It is a virtuous thing to be doing.
Brian Whittle.
It'll be interesting to have that conversation after we see the budget next week, where you've got a £1.5 billion black hole to fill, spending money that you don't have. You can negotiate.
If people want to intervene, they know how to do that. Otherwise, the person who has the floor, and we don't need sedentary commentary. Mr Whittle, please resume.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Coming back to Liz Smith's comments about balance, Presiding Officer, while the legislation being debated today asks us to consider the balance between the public's right to essential services and the right to trade unions to disrupt those services in pursuit of a better deal for those who provide them, I think it also raises the wider question of how the Scottish Government balances its priorities. What we have here, Deputy Presiding Officer, is more evidence, as if they were needed, that the SNP Government has its priorities all wrong. Just days before a budget that looks set to tell everyone in Scotland that they will pay the price for the SNP's economic incompetence, they have chosen to waste a debate in this chamber taking pot shots at the UK Government on a piece of legislation which, as Murdo Fraser pointed out, the Scottish Government have already said they will not apply. This is a distraction, Deputy Presiding Officer, pure and simple. The Scottish Government put even half of its effort it puts into political game playing into supporting Scotland's businesses, would be in a far better place. Instead, we see yet again that the only economy that grows under the SNP is the grievance economy, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whittle. I now call on Marie Todd to close on behalf of the Scottish Government. Minister, around 9 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Today's valuable debate has highlighted two important points. The first is the essential progressive role that trade unions play in delivering our fair work and our economic well-being ambitions.
Secondly, a discernible trend has emerged over the years under this Tory government, characterised by the persistent erosion of workers' rights, which this government will continue to defend against where we have the power to do so. Now, I have and I always will be a strong supporter of trade unions and their right. In my current portfolio in social care, I want the unions to be a key partner to help us to build a strong national care service. As we move forward, our commitment to partnership with trade unions remains unwavering, and we will persist in advocating for the devolution of employment powers. It's heartening to note a growing recognition of the pressing need for this crucial step amongst the wider trade union movement and the Scottish Parliament. But it is disappointing to note that despite the growing recognition amongst the Labour movement in Scotland that these powers should be devolved, senior UK Labour politicians continue to side with the Conservatives to block it. Labour's deputy leader Angela Rayner and Shadow Scottish Secretary Ian Murray have both in recent months ruled out supporting the devolution of employment law to this Parliament. I hope that Scottish Labour colleagues in this chamber will continue to encourage their colleagues at Westminster to support our calls. Yes.
Michael Marra.
I'm certainly welcome the point that she makes about trade unions being a partner in stopping her disastrous policies on the National Care Service as they stood. It's right she listened to them. Would she say that, recognise that today the Labour amendment sets out a series of principles that should be delivered in government? Is the idea that our backbenchers are saying that you shouldn't vote for something because you don't think it's going to happen is a very strange position to take.
Minister.
The Labour amendment asks us to have trust that they'll win the general election. That's a big if. Yeah. It asks us to have trust that if they win, they'll repeal the legislation. Again, that's a big if. Forgive me if myself and my colleagues are not content to wait for our neighbours in England to vote in a Labour government occasionally in order to fix this problem. That's been my life experience. I was 7 years old. Let me finish this point. I was 7 years old when Margaret Thatcher took power in the UK. 43 years on, we have had a Labour government for 13 years, in that intervening 43-year period. Scotland has never voted for a Tory government, but it gets a Tory government time and time and time again if England votes for it.
Michael Marra.
I do appreciate the Minister giving way again. I don't want to wait. I want to wait as short a time as possible for this legislation to be repealed. So should you not agree with me that there's more of a chance of that in a general election next year than there is in the idea that we might have independence sometimes in the next decade? Is the shortest time possible to get this legislation repealed is to get a Labour government. And why she won't back it in the amendment tonight?
Minister.
Labour have failed to devolve employment law to Scotland. The full devolution of employment law to the Scottish Parliament would enable us to pursue fair work goals such as setting the minimum wage, improving the gender pay gap reporting. These powers would enable us to create workplaces that are fairer, that bolster workers' rights in Scotland and contribute to combating poverty. That's what Scottish people want. That is what Scottish people keep voting for. Yes, we'd like to go a step further on these benches, because only with independence will Scotland have the full range of economic and other policy tools to take decisions based on Scotland's own needs. A new approach to fair work could be developed in an independent Scotland with full control over employment law, equality legislation, industrial relations and social security, enabling us to tackle inequalities. With independence, we'd have the power to introduce progressive measures like a real living wage and increased statutory sick pay. Independence would enable us to grow a green economy, tackle poverty head on, create opportunities to thrive, giving us the chance to replicate the success of our neighbouring countries, which are so much more prosperous, so much more productive, and so much fairer than the UK.
This debate has confirmed widespread opposition to the most recent of the UK government's anti-union legislation. Yes, I'll take an intervention.
Cara Mochan.
I really thank the member for taking an intervention. I think she was here when I was speaking. And what we're trying to do is come to some agreement. If I was to stand here and say my son has lived his entire life under an SNP government and I'm not sure that he's getting the delivery that he deserves in terms of education, you know, I could go over all of these things. What we're asking is there is something that we can come together and agree that would make a big difference in the short term. Would you come together with us on that point?
Minister.
So let me be clear. There is a lot of consensus between ourselves and Labour on this issue. We absolutely, along with the Welsh Government, along with the STUC and the TUC, oppose this. It is opposed by Westminster opposition parties, the House of Lords, and even drew criticism from members of the Conservative Party itself as it was going through Parliament. As my colleague stated at the outset, during a cost of living crisis, the government should be working with the public sector and the trade unions to reach fair and reasonable settlements, respecting the legitimate interests of workers, not seeking to curb that right to strike. Now, I've spoken, I've tried to explain to my Conservative colleagues that it's not at all clear for rail transport that people working on the Glasgow subway, on the Edinburgh trams, on ScotRail, and the Caledonian Sleeper, for Network Rail, will be protected from this minimum service legislation. But let me speak very clearly about the health service. So the consultation on minimum service levels for hospital levels that was just closed on the 14th of November was for hospital services in England, in Scotland, and in Wales. That is a reality. This member is shouting from a sedentary position. That is nonsense. It is absolutely true. The UK government have consulted GB-wide, not Northern Ireland, England, Wales and Scotland. And we are expected to trust that the precedent of non-application in Scotland that applied within the ambulance service regulations will be followed within the upcoming hospital service statements. Now, hospital service regulations. The decision to introduce in Scotland or not, unlike the position put forward by my Conservative colleagues, is entirely up to the Secretary of State. In this case, on the hospital regulations, that means it is Victoria Atkins who makes the decision, not the Scottish Government that makes the decision. And it is entirely unclear what will happen if health boards do not issue work notices. We don't know what will happen after that. So I reiterate, this government remains strongly opposed to the strikes, the Minimum Service Levels Act, and any associated secondary legislation which could be applied in Scotland and therefore encroach on devolved services. We view this legislation as unnecessary, unwanted, and ineffective. It seeks to undermine legitimate trade union activity and it does not respect fair work principles. The Scottish Government firmly believes that a progressive approach to industrial relations and to trade unionism is absolutely at the heart of a fairer, more successful society. The right to strike for fair pay and for safe work conditions should be an integral part of the rights of citizens in Scotland and right across the UK. We are committed to working with the STUC and affiliates in responding to the cost of living crisis, creating a well-being economy and working towards a just transition to net zero. In complete contrast to the UK government, which continues to take
an anti-trade union and an anti-fair work stance. Our distinct approach is based on partnership working and our endorsement of the Fair Work Convention's framework. We call on this Parliament to recognise and endorse that approach. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate on application of the Strikes Minimum Service Levels Act 2023 in Scotland, and it is now time to move on to the next item of business. And I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now, and I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed? Thank you. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. And can I remind members that if the amendment in the name of Murdo Fraser is agreed to, the amendment in the name of Daniel Johnson will fall. The first question is that Amendment 11652.1 in the name of Murdo Fraser, which seeks to amend Motion 11652 in the name of Neil Gray, on application of the Strikes Minimum Service Levels Act 2023 in Scotland be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote, and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.